Okay, let's get one thing out of the way right off the bat. Nobody likes the Grammys. I genuinely don't think I've heard anyone talk positively about the Grammys in my lifetime, and I don't really think it was any better before I was born. One of the criticisms I see thrown most often at the Grammys is that they're disconnected from what the people are listening to, and that they focus on commercially viable projects at the expense of innovative, more groundbreaking records. This has especially been the case in hip-hop, and while I don't want to go too in-depth, I think it's pretty uncontroversial to say that this should have lost to literally any of these. The 63rd Grammys, however, held on March 14th, 2021, seem to be shaking things up a bit with some more daring picks. Royce da 5'9 and J Electronica, the anti-vax dream team, both put out decent records this year, and the Alchemist produced Freddie Gibbs' Project Alfredo was a huge darling of online rap fans, who'd been speaking highly of Freddie's previous material for nearly a decade. Throw in D-Smoke's immaculately produced Black Habits, and truthfully any four of these artists would have been great picks for Rap Album of the Year. But none of these people ended up winning, as out of nowhere, the 47-year-old Nas took the crown with his 12th studio album, King's Disease. Nas winning this year elicited pretty mixed reactions from online communities. From what I can tell, everyone was in agreement that Nas deserved a Grammy, but many were skeptical of King's Disease being the album to finally give it to him. Nas has a huge discography full of critically acclaimed albums, and a late career project such as this kind of seemed like a weird time to finally reward him for his efforts. The thing is though, this wasn't a typical late career project. It may have been his 12th studio album and the man himself may have been pushing 50, but King's Disease isn't about Nas giving up the throne. It's about celebrating his coronation. Before we can get into King's Disease and its successors, it's important to take inventory on where Nas was at this point in his career. Nas is one of the few rappers who've released music in four separate decades, and going into the 2020s, it's not unreasonable to say that he stood on rather shaky ground. The 2010s began with Distant Relatives, a collaborative hip-hop slash reggae fusion project with Damian Marley, the son of reggae legend Bob Marley. Released on May 18th, 2010, this album is certainly a different beast than your typical Nas release, featuring lots of African influence and plenty of live studio instrumentation. The songs here are extremely melodic and diverse, and the colorful production is bright and rich, giving both Nas and Marley plenty of time to shine. This project as a whole just puts me in a good mood. It's very danceable and earnest. I definitely recommend giving it a shot, even if you're not sure you're gonna like it, because there's a lot to love here. Regardless, the album was a critical and commercial success, selling over 57,000 copies in its first week, with the two artists choosing to donate all proceeds to charity. Despite this success, however, many fans were left eagerly anticipating Nas's next solo studio album, and the man would finally deliver in 2012, debuting atop the Billboard 200 with the luxurious Life is Good. Fueled by the emotional whirlwind of his divorce from singer-songwriter Kellis, Nas ended up recording what would turn out to be by far his most sensitive and mature album yet, covering themes such as nostalgia, relationships, and especially aging. The world's so ill, yo, I want a girl so real, who not after material wealth, but get dough still. Or maybe an educator, a lady with etiquette, who could be from out the hood or either work for the president. On a production standpoint, Life is Good contrasts these themes by accentuating Nas' success, featuring a combination of glitzy, maximalist instrumentation, and classic boom bap beats that wonderfully tie the album together with the rest of his past. This album gets compared a lot to 444 by Jay-Z, another old man rap album, though personally, I feel like both these albums set out to do very different things, which they both accomplish in their own way. If I had to choose a favorite, I would ultimately give the edge to 444, but Life is Good is right up there in terms of emotional poignancy and sophistication. Following Life is Good, Nas would take a break from releasing music, teasing collaborations here and there, but never with the final product to show for it. In 2016, Nas literally featured on a song titled Nas Album Done from DJ Khaled's album Major Key, but nothing ever came of it. That is, until April of 2018, when, of all people, Kanye West announced that Nas's next studio album would be released on June 15th, 2018. This came out of nowhere and caught a lot of people off guard, though, funnily enough, it's actually keeping a promise that Kanye made to Obama, of all people, so good on them for delivering, I guess. The album would indeed come, and the final project, Nasir, was released to a unanimous... So, Nasir is a product of the Wyoming Sessions, alongside four other albums that Kanye produced in the summer of 2018. These were all created at once in a very small period of time, but Nasir had particularly rushed development. As in, according to Nas, the album was created the week it was scheduled to release.
He was working on a lot. He had Cudi, Teyana Taylor, he had his album, and I was the only one coming in starting fresh. So I got the less time with him. You know, we really did that album like that week that it was supposed to come out.
As a result of this development cycle, Nasir isn't bad, but it really feels like the bare minimum amount of quality I should be getting from a Nas and Kanye album. This should have been a dream collaboration. I mean, Kanye initially rose to fame alongside Jay-Z, producing a majority of his hits at a time where Jay and Nas were in one of the most famous feuds in hip-hop history. These two have a past together, and their music should reflect that, but in the end, Nasir feels unfortunately undercooked. There are a couple good songs here. I personally really enjoy both Adam and Eve and Simple Things, but the majority of these tracks are just lackluster and boring. Nas doesn't have nearly the energy he had on Distant Relatives or Life is Good, and as a result, the final product is way too rough and unfocused for me to be able to give it a solid recommendation. Nasir was a disappointment, in my opinion outright mediocre, and as a result, Nas was in a bit of a precarious spot. Though still one of the most acclaimed rappers of all time, Nas's music was starting to become less and less enjoyable to audiences, and his discography was getting messier and messier. To many, Nas was a has-been, unable to recapture the magic of Illmatic or It Was Written, and it was clear that some form of course correction was going to be necessary for him to find himself on top again. Enter Hit-Boy. First popping off in the early 2010s, Hit-Boy is responsible for some of the biggest hits of the last decade, producing anthemic bangers for the likes of Kanye West, Travis Scott, Kendrick Lamar, and ASAP Rocky. His style of production is cinematic and sleek, emphasizing grandiosity and memorability. Hit-Boy would first collaborate with Nas in 2012 during the Life is Good sessions, where he provided the beat for a song titled No Such Thing as a White Jesus that reportedly would have featured Frank Ocean on the chorus. Unfortunately, Hit-Boy ended up losing the digital file for the song, and the two wouldn't end up working together again for over half a decade, until early 2020 when the two met up in Hit-Boy's personal studio in LA. According to Hit-Boy, the two immediately hit it off like crazy, with Nas in an open and creative zone. For every beat that he provided, Nas would build something on top of it, and the two went back and forth like this for multiple high-energy sessions. They decided to let the room lead the way, and the natural chemistry that erupted between them as a result eventually brought them to the conclusion that they simply had to produce a full-length album together. And this, finally, brings us back to King's Disease.
King's Disease, Nas.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, so I know I've been hyping up the trilogy this whole video, but I'll be real with you. KD1 isn't my favorite of the Nas Hit-Boy projects, not by a long shot. In fact, I'd probably put this at the bottom if I was interested in ranking these albums, but don't for a second think that means this album is anything less than exemplary. Beginning with the name, King's Disease, it really brings to mind some vivid imagery, and the album art for this project suits that title perfectly. Nas hired Afro-Cuban artist Harmonia Rosales for the cover, basically only giving her the name of the project to work with, and in return, she delivered an absolutely stunning piece. Rosales explained that she wanted to represent the full life cycle of a king by specifically focusing on the color red, which is associated with sacrifice not in the devil way that American society has adopted, but sacrifice metaphorically in all aspects of life, sacrifices to get to where you're at. As a result, this artwork is rich and indulgent, which is exactly what Nas was going for. King's Disease, by definition, is synonymous with gout, an ailment that was typically associated with royalty due to it coming about as a result of overconsumption and gluttonous behavior. Nas wanted to build on this idea. What happens to a person when they've reached the top, and what do they worry about?
So you look at it and you go, all right, King, what do you do now with this position? You get drunk with power? Is it women? Is it, what are you allowing to take your time, and what is happening that can take you off of your throne? Be aware of it.
The first song on King's Disease is the title track, and this song acts as sort of an intro to the entire trilogy, as it's actually this track that Nas would ultimately name the album after. This track really captures everything the phrase King's Disease stands for. The beat swirls around you with warmth before Nas enters with what's essentially a mission statement, boasting about his own status and fame while simultaneously encouraging others to be intelligent kings themselves by avoiding jealousy and gluttony.
Cause you are not a king if you can't come out a thing that you got yourself in, claiming nobody helping. The stupidest part of Africa produced blacks that started algebra, proof facts. Imagine if you knew that as a child.
Nas himself sounds great on this song, with his delivery being reserved yet passionate. It really feels like he's drawing from an infinite supply of wisdom earned through years of experience, and that through that, all he really wants is to empower others. The lead single Ultra Black follows a similar theme, seeing Nas emphatically celebrating everything and everyone black, except Doja Cat for some reason. The Hit-Boy beat here is subdued, with some really nice jazzy chords making up the backbone of the track, before it begins to introduce some blinking electronics in the second half that provide the song with a really positive vibe.
So yes, God bless success. We going ultra black, like the S is fast. Hawk with a mask on.
the freshest breath. African black soap caress the flesh. Superfly the Mac, sitting fly in the lac. Take the boat on the water, history talks with my daughter.
King's Disease isn't all sweet reflections, though. Blue Benz is a thunking, heavy song with a hauntingly breathy vocal sample that kind of reminds me of something off Illmatic, at least tonally. Halfway through, one of Hit-Boy's signature beat changes bring some staggered hi-hats into the mix, a really clever way of modernizing a song that pays homage so heavily to the past. 27 Summers takes this concept even further, with Hit-Boy providing a true modern trap beat for Nas to grace, as he speaks on the 27 years that have passed since the release of his debut album. Though short, this track is only the first of numerous examples across the KD trilogy where Nas rides on the beats of his younger contemporaries, and even here he proves that he can easily hang alongside them.
Latin food in the back room, big business, I'ma drop a new yak soon, following the cash rules. Rich, matte black rose, yeah I gotta see in ghosts.
Nas and Hit-Boy continue to synthesize old and new on this album, with a lot of unexpectedly modern features. These are admittedly pretty hit or miss. For example, Replace Me features Big Sean, with Don Toliver providing the chorus. I can promise you right now that I've never once thought of or asked for a Big Sean and Nas collab, but these two actually work decently well on this track, boasting on lost relationships that they think are going to be harder for the other person than themselves. Don Toliver's chorus, however, is pretty weak and repetitive, appearing three times in a song less than that many minutes long, and in my opinion greatly holds back the rest of the track. Till the War is Won with Lil Durk is a lot closer to a perfect fusion of styles. The song is actually just beautiful, with these serene piano chords opening the record while Nas extends his invitation of kinghood to black mothers and women in general. The song feels genuinely impactful and heartfelt, and Durk's verse at the end is just the icing on the cake. His smooth timbre really nicely contrasts the weathered texture of Nas's voice, and the final product is something I can only describe as heavenly.
I give all I have to the war's won.
I was serving at my mama's crib, she ain't know about it. Complaining about my ring, but I know my mama gave me. She told me to be a man and never sleep through problems. University of the streets ain't plan on going.
This album has a lot of variety in terms of style, and as a result, it's hard to pin down a distinct sound here. Even the coziest of songs on KD1, like the title track, feel sort of distant and muted, like they're holding back a little bit. Despite nostalgia being such a prevalent theme here, it never feels intimate in the way that Life is Good managed. Take Full Circle, for instance, a song reuniting Nas with the other members of his former supergroup, The Firm. With it having been over 20 years since their debut and only album, the song kind of lacks the grandiosity and heart that you'd expect from such a reunion, even if on its own it's a perfectly serviceable track. I don't think this is necessarily a bad thing for the album, as it ties in well with the central theme of King's Disease. To a peasant, what is a king? He's someone that provides security, and thus comfort in that sense, but he's also to be respected, and you're not likely to feel very connected to him as an individual. I like to think that that's the mindset Nas and Hit-Boy had when constructing this album, as while thematically KD1 is open and inviting, it feels sort of aloof in its musicality. King's Disease, to me, is the perfect January album. It's a colder project, a little somber, but it's also romantic in how Nas displays his affections for life. I think no song is a better example of that than the outro, The Cure. Straight up, this is one of my favorite rap songs period, and it's a flawless summary of what the rest of the project stands for. In the first half of this track, Nas raps over one of the most dignified instrumentals on the album, sounding more royal than ever as he once again discusses the titular King's Disease. He treats it like a curse, forced to constantly outdo himself and perform to the standards people hold him to, yet he isn't worried about failing. At this point, Nas has more than cemented himself, and he's instead dispensing advice to those who someday hope to achieve what he has. The first half of the song wraps up the story of the album before Nas tells Hit-Boy to roll the credits, bringing in a truly delicious beat switch that Nas uses as one final excuse to be braggadocious before the curtains fall.
Roll the credits. Cuban link, QB chain, belonging to MoMA.
The Cure ends King's Disease on a triumphant, relaxed note, encapsulating this album to a T. While KD1 isn't perfect, I can still say that its sentimental tone of veneration remains wonderfully enjoyable to this day. I can confidently say now that I really do believe this project deserved to win the Grammy for Best Rap Album. As much as I enjoy Alfredo and the other nominees, King's Disease allowed Nas to prove that he could still make an incredibly tight and enjoyable record in the modern era, and for that it should be commended. And then they did it again.
Jeez, yeah, yeah, QBAQ Ravens.
Nas and Hit-Boy clearly had no intention of slowing down, as less than a year later, the two would follow up King's Disease with the aptly titled sequel, King's Disease 2. Immediately, KD2 strikes me as a much more focused project than its predecessor. Comparing the covers alone is enough to illustrate the difference. The vibrant reddish-orange of KD2 is a very different aesthetic to its comparatively subdued predecessor, and this extends directly into the music as well. Compared to King's Disease 1, KD2 feels warmer and more passionate, and that can be chalked up to Hit-Boy's change in production style. This album features a heavy reliance on soul samples and vocal passages, giving the sound a full and open feel. Take a listen to the intro, The Pressure, and you'll hear what I mean right away. Mimicking this change in direction, Nas really stepped up his game in terms of both delivery and flow on this project. While I would never say that Nas sounded bad on the first installment, there were definitely a few places where he sounded a little rustier than I would have liked, and those moments, while sparing, are completely absent now on King's Disease 2. Nas is so at ease with his rapping here that it really just makes every verse a treat to listen to. You can hear and feel his age, yet he's still hungry with his delivery. You can hear the energy for yourself on Rare, the lead single, and actually the first song from any of these projects that I heard. Nas claims to be in rare form here, and as the track progresses, he only continues to make good on that claim, beginning by absolutely demolishing this first verse.
Yo, I'm in rare form. Niggas speak down on my name like I wasn't there for 'em. Talk about back in the days, this isn't back in the days. Hit with me back in my ways, should do for the fade.
Rare begins sounding slower and old-fashioned, but experiences an immaculate beat change halfway through that brings with it a heavier bassline and some clappy percussion as Nas picks up the pace of his verse. When the beat changes the third time, you barely even notice as it seamlessly transitions to a fast-paced trap banger.
I'm putting on for the G's. We've been doing gangsta shit for a long time. Look inside my mind, see a gold mine. I'm my own cosign, she texting the old line.
Rare is one of the best songs on any of these projects, and thankfully, a lot of King's Disease 2 isn't that far behind. Store Run features one of the lushest and most fiery beats on the album, while Nas drops some of his coldest bars from across the entire trilogy. I'm from the era of razor blades and coke dust, people living with no trust, champagne and the soap suds. Oh my god, I mean that's one of my absolute favorite lines from Nas, and the entire song is packed with lyrics like this.
The addicts. What happens when kings don't see their potential status? What's your exit plan? Face to face with my omens, I never ran. Stood on stages, most never can. Pyrotechnics and leather pants. Shifting the culture.
Nas continues to flex his lyricism through storytelling, which has always been one of his greatest strengths as a rapper. On Death Row East, he discusses the ill-fated East Coast branch of Death Row Records, and elaborates more on the relationship between him and the late Tupac Shakur. The track ends with a sample of a recording from the night that Tupac died, wherein Nas stopped his own concert in order to honor his fellow artist. The end result is a really narratively complex and intriguing track, backed with a fittingly sinister yet deeply catchy instrumental.
Let's talk about it. Cause when you got a story real as mine, you can't leave nothing out it. Take you back to 9-6 diamonds and Mac 10s, looking through a fresh lens. Everything I knew now, wish I knew back then.
Changing topics a bit, I think I made it clear that I wasn't the biggest fan of all the features on King's Disease, and I'm extremely happy to report that KD2 is an improvement across the board. The greater overall consistency and sound with this album signifies a more rounded guest list than before, and it helps that the featured artists really seem to be putting in extraordinary work themselves. Charlie Wilson's the only returning feature from King's Disease 1, and in my opinion, he really improved upon his initial appearance. While Cardi 5 off KD1 was a nostalgically sweet enough romp down memory lane, No Phony Love flies far higher in comparison. Wilson's intro is rich and powerful, and Nas delivers two long, intimate verses about past relationships, letting his guard down more than he ever did on the previous installment.
No phony love, if only love, guaranteed trust, just to sum it up. You know what's up, it's only us, it's only us, it's only us.
There are two features on this project that shine brighter than the others, though, being Eminem on EPMD2 and Lauryn Hill on Nobody. Nas collaborating with these two bona fide living legends is exactly the type of grandiosity that an album named King's Disease should be striving for, in my opinion. Eminem has long gone on record claiming to be a huge fan of Nas, so it's really gratifying to finally see the two of them hop on a track together. EPMD2 in general is an electrifying track, also featuring the titular legendary hip-hop duo EPMD. Nas sounds hungrier and more energetic than ever on this song. His flow is absolutely ridiculous, but obviously Eminem is the real draw here, delivering a long, bizarrely Christmas-themed verse that still easily steals the show without falling into the typical pitfalls of modern Slim Shady.
Pain pill the drink, I just pray for the day when I'm able to say that I'm placed with the greats and my names with the Kanes and the Waynes and the Jays and the Drays and the Yays and the Drakes and the Jay Dillis Jay, this cool Jays and the Ra's and Amaze and his Nas's and praise to the gods and his shout to the gods.
Nobody, by contrast, is decidedly relaxed and abstract. The concept of willingly giving up the status of king is discussed here, as Nas dreams of a place where he could just be nobody again. This idea makes Lauryn Hill the absolutely perfect feature, and she comes in with a passionate, evocative verse just as good as I could have hoped for. The two of them together represent so much to the greater hip-hop community, and seeing them reflect on that status with such maturity and grace is awe-inspiring.
Some place to be nobody.
All my time is spent focused on my freedom now. Why would I join him when I know that I could beat him now?
King's Disease 2 devotes less time to the titular ailment than its predecessor, but on tracks like Nobody, it remains in full force. This album feels timeless in a way that's very unlike its predecessor, and I believe it all ties back to just how comfortable Nas is with himself. Where KD1 felt like Nas wanted to honor the past through both the production and lyricism, KD2 is more like he's cherishing the time he spent on Earth from the present. Now that he's so unworried and reassured, Nas would rather live in the now as opposed to continuing to retread his past, deciding to rule as a benevolent king rather than an insecure one. He carries this energy into the closer, Nas is good, a play off the phrase God is good. This affirmation goes a long way in making Nas sound cool and collected, yet still unabashedly optimistic, and the energy he brings here is just infectious. Like The Cure, Nas makes it clear that the king's disease is contagious, and hearing him now, it's pretty hard to deny the appeal of catching it yourself.
In the Red Sea, took a boat on a now. It's in my blood to drive these cars and live as laws. Escobar cigars, avoiding the prison bars. Nas. I deserve the threads in my closet. Big boy deposits, Nike shares and stock tips.
It should be obvious at this point that I think King's Disease 2 is far and away the better project compared to its predecessor, and honestly, I don't even think it's close. KD2 masterfully executes everything that KD1 strove for, and then some, gaining an identity of its own through the sheer excellence of its songwriting. This album doesn't feel like the second installment in a series. It's so tightly constructed that I honestly have something to say about every single one of these songs, and the only reason I didn't is because I didn't want this video to go over an hour long. King's Disease 2 absolutely shocked me upon release. I mean, here was Nas delivering a project that wasn't only a return to form, but genuinely one of the best hip-hop albums I've heard so far this decade. My complaints here are pretty few and far between. I don't think this project is perfect necessarily, but tiny nitpicks could never subtract from the masterpiece that is King's Disease 2. Before, the question was where does Nas go from here, but on these two projects, Nas has earned the right to boldly answer that he's going nowhere. He doesn't need to, he's more than proved himself, and it's hard to even imagine a higher ceiling than the one he's already shattered. To elevate his craft even further would take a miracle, an act of God, or even a touch of magic.
I don't even know what's going on no more. I don't even know what's happening, man. There ain't no answers. I'ma figure some shit out though, yeah.
Okay, I know that was silly, but I had to transition somehow. So, King's Disease 2 released on August 6, 2021, and immediately after, Nas and Hit-Boy began work on a potential King's Disease 3. Their initial sessions were fruitful, yet the songs that came out of them carried a very different vibe than that of the previous King's Disease installments. Unwilling to let their hard work go to waste, and dedicated to keeping thematic consistency within the King's Disease series, the two decided the best course of action would be to release these tracks anyways as a gift to their fans, and to help hold them over until the release of the third King's Disease. This would come to fruition in the form of Magic, surprise announced and dropped on Christmas Eve of 2021. A fitting timeframe is that the sound here is far chillier than that of the summery KD2. I compared King's Disease 1 to a January winter, hopeful yet brisk. Using that same analogy, Magic is like a freezing December blizzard, staining and raw in its intensity. Magic is only 9 tracks long, a far cry from the 15-song KD2, yet it utilizes its short runtime to deliver some of the punchiest verses Nas has ever spit in his near 30-year career. I mentioned that Nas felt comfortable and secure on KD2, but here he sounds more than ever like he has something to prove. He doesn't, and he knows that he doesn't, and while before he utilized that privilege from the seat of the throne, now he's getting nasty in the streets. Hit-Boy's beats are equally exciting this time around, foregoing the intimate and lush sound of the previous project, and instead embracing traditionally grimy New York-style instrumentals to incredible success. The beats on this project are simple and traditional in the best way, granting every song a Nas forward feel while maintaining stylistic consistency throughout. Ugly might be my favorite beat on the project. The instrumental is heavy and muddled, just like its bleak subject matter, where Nas mourns the tragically common violence in his home city by equating it to the unpredictability of the weather.
Yeah. It's ugly outside, as muggy as money outside. 105 Fahrenheit, thunderous skies. The cloud shape, a clown face above where you reside. Under reside.
Magic is relentless in its intensity throughout the entire half-hour runtime, the majority of which is spent alone with Nas. Wave Gods is home to the only two features here, A$AP Rocky and DJ Premier. Rocky always sounds good on these beats in my opinion, and naturally he performs impeccably alongside Nas, whose inflection and tone are simply on another level with this track. In the chorus, Nas compares him and Hit-Boy to the likes of DJ Premier and Prodigy's Gangstar, and at this point, who could argue with him? These two have now proven on three separate albums that their chemistry together is unmatched, and Wave Gods is just another addition to their ever-growing library.
Crash, no comparison, we more solid than they are. Me and Hit-Boy, they say we like the new Gangstar. Me and Flocko, they say we the new Wave Gods. Shout to Max B, he could be home any day, God.
Really, the only moment of brevity you're gonna get on this album, if you can even call it that, is found on Woo for the Children. It's not often that Nas raps on drumless beats, and in this case, it really only further accentuates his raw technical ability. The lyricism is on point here as always, but there's something about his flow that's just so incredibly satisfying to listen to.
Like a high-speed chase, trunk full of smack, tallest building in Manhattan, sipping on Manhattans, listen to the Manhattans. Queens of Brooklyn, oh what a feeling, I should've had Grammys when No Dirty said Woo for the Children, should've did that.
While Magic isn't technically part of the Cadence Disease trilogy, I think it would have been both impossible and disingenuous to talk about these albums without also bringing up this one. It stands tall as a testament to the rapport between Nas and Hit-Boy, but even taking Hit-Boy out of the equation, I think it's very safe to say that Nas is rapping on a level here never before seen. This record easily beats KD1 for me, and I think it's probably about on the level of King's Disease 2 in terms of enjoyability. A lot of people consider this project the best out of Nas's recent output, and I can totally see why. It brings to the table a distinct tone that's close in spirit to Nas's classics while still retaining the spark of the King's Disease trilogy. If you're a fan of old school hip-hop and you haven't heard Magic yet, you're doing yourself a disservice. This is a great starting point for anyone curious about Nas's music, and with as short as it is, you really can't go wrong by giving it a listen. Magic is when it became impossible to discount Nas, but even here he seemed like he wanted to reach higher. I mean, it takes a certain level of confidence to announce your next album in the lyrics of the one you've just released, but it's even more audacious to treat Magic as such a throwaway project. If this is what Nas considers simple food for his fans, then what could he possibly have cooking in the oven? Alright, and that is actually going to be the end of part one here. You guys can enjoy this footage of me and Tyler playing FPS chess like a year ago. As I kind of talk a little casually at the end of this video to just kind of give an update on where the channel is. I initially wanted this video to be only one part, and I was going to talk about King's Disease 1, KD2, Magic, King's Disease 3, and then kind of wrap it all up, but I realized as I was making this video that I'd had a lot to say about King's Disease 3, and about how I just think that album is... I don't want to get into it here, that's why I'm making another video, but I have a lot of things I want to say about King's Disease 3, and I initially wanted to kind of skim over it in this first video, in this one-parter, because I was like, okay, we build up to how Nas has revitalized his career, and then King's Disease 3 is the victory lap. But I didn't want to diminish that album's importance, because to me, it's one of the quintessential rap albums that maybe I've ever heard, and I thought, you know, lowering its status to just like the end credits of Nas and Hit-Boy's album run is kind of doing it a disservice. And then, about halfway through making this fucking video, 50 Cent randomly announced that he was going to be working with Nas and Hit-Boy on King's Disease 4. So this video is instantly outdated because I've spent the entire series, or the entire video so far, talking about how it's the King's Disease trilogy, and even then that kind of didn't make sense because Magic is right there. So the idea now is that this is going to be part one, and it's going to be covering what you've seen so far. And then part two is going to go into a deep dive on King's Disease 3. I want to talk about everything about that album. I want to talk about every song in depth and what it means to me and what I think it means to hip-hop and Nas's career. There's a lot I have to say about King's Disease 3 that hopefully won't be invalidated by King's Disease 4 by the time that comes out. And that's what part three is going to focus on. I want to talk about whatever that album might be. I don't know if it's going to be just like a straight review. It'll probably be another analysis dissection, similar to what I do with King's Disease 3, but that album isn't out yet, so it's pretty up in the air what I'm going to have to say about that, and therefore the format of that video is also pretty up in the air. With that being said, I want part 2 to be out relatively soon. Relatively soon, by the way, in these terms, is like within 6 months. My non-official deadline is that King's Disease 3 video has to be finished before King's Disease 4 comes out. But I want to get it out sooner than that. We don't know when King's Disease 4 is coming out, so I don't know how much wiggle room that's giving me, how realistic of a goal that is, but that's the hope right now. And I want to make other video essays here too. I had so much fun working on this video, and it took me a long time. I started this project in November, and I worked on it on and off throughout that time, and I want to continue. I have a lot of other ideas for video essays, both music and non-music related, a couple video game ones. I even maybe have like a movie, TV show type thing I want to talk about, but that's going to be for later if that ever comes out. I have a lot of ideas. I have a lot of terrible opinions. I love to hear myself talk. I love to edit myself talking. So my narcissism knows no bounds. There will be more content on this channel in the future. But yeah, thank you guys so much for watching this video so far, and hopefully we will have more parts out soon. Like and share this video if you did enjoy it. It does help a lot and it helps get exposure out, though. Honestly, this video was a passion project for me. I'm gonna make more even if you guys didn't like this video. That's just gonna be the reality of it. You're gonna have to deal with it. And yeah, I think that's all I really had to say. So I want you guys to have a good night and take care.